worship God in this place. Good to be home. Good to be back on this this cold Thanksgiving week. Amen. We're going to give Him praise today and worship His name. Lord, we thank You for today and for, God, Your grace and mercy. We pray Your blessing on our time as we gather. Lord, may You touch our heart. Holy Spirit, may You move in this place. We give You praise. We thank You so much for this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Washes over me. You have made me new now. sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name have I ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name have I ever known. No sweeter name, no sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name have I ever known. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name have I ever known.
Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you.
And Jesus, we love you. And know how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Tell him this morning, Jesus. And Jesus, we love you. And know how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Lord, we love you this morning. You are the one our hearts adore, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust in the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. Sing that again. My hope is built. Thank you, Jesus. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust in the sweetest frame, but only trust in Jesus' name. Oh, Christ.
Yeah.
seen. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes and wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Oh Lord, oh Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever be. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes and wonder. thing I will build. Oh, I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Church, are you thankful today that when we put our trust and our hope in Him, we will not be shaken? Lord, we're so thankful that we can stand on You, the solid rock. God, everything else is shifting and shaking and moving, but on You, You are the solid rock that we can stand. Lord, we can put our trust and our hope and our faith in You. Lord, we will not be disappointed.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, the words of the song that we sang a little bit ago that says our affection and our devotion that we pour out on Your feet. Lord, I can't help but thinking in this season of thankfulness, this season of reflection and remembrance, and as we focus on what You have done for us, Lord, today we just take a couple minutes and we pour out our affection and our devotion, our thankfulness, our gratefulness at Your feet today. Lord, You are worthy of our praise. You are worthy of our devotion, of our adoration, of all of our affection and our attention. Lord, You have done so much for us and we don't deserve it. Your mercy, it's new every morning, and Your grace extends to us constantly.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, You are worthy, worthy of every song, worthy of every breath we take, of every praise that we sing. Church, just take just a minute. We're not going to stay here long. Just take a minute out loud, outside of your head, and just tell Him thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for what You've done for me.
Our hearts adore. Oh, Jesus, we love You.
Tell Him, church. Just tell Him, raise your hands out, Jesus. Oh, we love You.
You are the one our hearts adore. Oh, Jesus, we love You. And Jesus, we love You. And oh, how we love You.
Jesus. God, as we just continue on this morning, God, as we stay in this attitude of thankfulness, of gratitude for what You have done, Lord, I pray that You would just open our hearts, open our ears and our eyes to just hear and see and receive what you're saying today. Lord, we want to hear you. We want to draw near to you. We want to be more like you. So, Lord, speak to us and help us to hear with ears open, with feet ready to respond in obedience to what you're saying. We love you. Jesus, we worship you. We praise your name. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. It's good to be with you. I'm going to go ahead and dismiss Pastor Mark and our kids. Let's give them a hand. We love our children's ministry. We love our children's pastor. And we're just grateful to see what God's doing in their heart and life. You know, it's Thanksgiving week. And hey, I just want to remind you, I do want to say, if you don't have a place to be this year for Thanksgiving, we've had a couple of families say, hey, we would love to host somebody that needs a place to go. So let me know, talk to one of the staff, and we can get you connected with those individuals, but they would love to host you if you don't have a place. We're grateful for what God's done, and that's really where I want to go this morning. I want to highlight a couple of Thanksgiving, really Thanksgiving passages, gratitude passages that we see in Scripture. And here's the thing: this week we're going to sit down at a Thanksgiving dinner. We're going to watch the Dallas Cowboys win. Praise God! We all know that's going to happen. Only if they're wearing the blue jerseys, because they usually lose if they wear the white ones. But we're going to be with family. We're going to be with friends. We're going to offer a prayer of thanksgiving to the Lord. We're going to say how grateful we are, and all of that's good. I want to encourage that. I want to say do that. Offer thanksgiving to God for what he's done. But perhaps this year, we can take it a little further. We can take it to the next step and move beyond just a day. And I want to encourage you in this, that we move into Christmas, and we move into Easter, and we move into Pentecost, and we move into Mother's Day and Father's Day, all the way through the year with this heart of thanksgiving in our life, where we give everything to the one who has offered everything. The Lord deserves all of us, amen. And this season that we're in, this time that we're in, it's an opportunity to recall all of the wonderful things of God. It's an opportunity to say, look what the Lord has done, and thank God for all the many blessings that he's given us in our life. Here's the thing, if I'm living the life of thanksgiving, I'm expressing my praise to God. And I want to expound on that a little bit this morning. Jesus is meant to be praised. He's meant to be exalted and lifted up. The psalmist says, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. The scripture says, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. And I want to draw your attention to Psalms 100. It is going to be our text this morning. Just let me pray for you as we read the word, that God would speak to our hearts. Heavenly Father, we give you the next few minutes, the next few moments, Lord, with gratitude in our heart, with thanksgiving in our heart and in our soul. And we say thank you, God, for who you are. Thank you for the promises of God. Thank you for the freedoms of God. Thank you, Lord, for everlasting life that you've given us. And today we just want to acknowledge your goodness and your greatness. We want to acknowledge your power and how mighty you are. You are the Almighty God, O Most High, Jesus Christ, the Messiah. And we want to say thank you for that. And I pray this morning that we won't leave here without having the seed of God planted in our heart and life that causes change and growth on the inside of us. We thank you this morning. Everybody said amen. Psalms 100, verse 1, it says this. This is a psalm of giving thanks. It says, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Look what it says. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us. We are his people and the sheep of his pastures. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and with his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. I love that. Every single generation. God is faithful to all generations. Listen, God alone is worthy of being worshiped. And what is your thoughts and your attitude toward worship today? Do you willingly come and joyfully come into the presence of God? Or are you just going through the motions, reluctantly going to church, halfway serving God? Where are you at? The scripture tells us to remember God's goodness, to remember God's dependability, and then to worship him with a thanksgiving in our heart, with a praise in our heart and our soul. It's this grateful, 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 grateful God. Today I'm grateful, I'm thankful God. It's this attitude. David had this attitude when he said, not to us, but to you goes all the glory for your unfailing love and faithfulness. And another passage of scripture we have is in Colossians chapter 2, where Paul said to let our lives spill over, let your life overflow with the thanksgivings for all he was done. Let it overflow, let it spill over, because God is worthy of my praise. So he should get my praise, right? He should get every part of my life. Paul would go on and say that he's blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing. So we think about the many spiritual blessings. We'll look at those here in a minute. But we should be grateful and thankful that God has given us talents. And God has given us skills and abilities. And he's given us opportunities. He's given us spiritual blessings like salvation, everlasting life. Praise God. Aren't you thankful? Health. The Bible says he's the God that heals us. He bore our griefs and our sicknesses and diseases, and by his stripes we're healed. He's a God of provision. And if you obey the commands of the Lord with the finances that he's given you, the Bible says that the windows of heaven are opened up in your life and blessings are poured on you that you cannot contain. Amen. Provision. He provides for us. He's Jehovah Jireh. It's a privilege to worship the Lord. It's a privilege to serve the Lord. God, I'm grateful for to be of use and of service to you. So does your life flow forth with this thanksgiving to where it's spilling over into people's hearts and lives? Another good verse that Paul wrote in Corinthians where he says, thank God for this gift. Thank God for salvation. Thank God for grace, for this gift that's too wonderful to explain. It's too wonderful for words. This morning I want to give you four examples of scripture, you know, that talk a little bit about thanksgiving. We see this gratitude in people's life as we go through the scripture. And they serve as a reminder of us to express our gratitude to God. The first one's in Luke chapter 1, verse 35. And it's with Mary. And we're getting ready to enter the Christmas season. And we see Mary's gratitude in this moment. Mary focuses on who God is and what God is has done for her by saying, thank you, God, for blessing me. Thank you, God, for using me. Thank you for opportunities. Thank you for privileges. And she would say, my soul magnifies the Lord. Luke chapter 1, verse 35, it says, the angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, so the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. For no word from God will ever fail. Come on. Don't you love that? No word. No word from God. No promise from God will ever fail. She says, I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled. And the angel left her. We go down to verse 42. Mary visits Elizabeth, and in a loud voice, Elizabeth exclaims, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child that you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? And as soon as the sound of the greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill the promises of God. Come on. I love that. Verse 46, Mary would offer the thanksgiving, the hymn. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he's been mindful of the humble state of this servant, this person who I am. And from now on, all generations will call me blessed. Talk about walking in the assurance of God and in the promises of God. Look at that bold statement. From now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the mighty one has done great things for me. Mary's saying, thank you, God, for blessing me. Thank you, God, for picking me, for using me. Listen, recall the greatness of God. Recall the wonderful things that God has done for you, and let it be an encouragement for you to step into the dream, step into the purpose, and do the things that God's called you to do. Recall the blessings of God. Mary overflowed with this heart of joy and thanksgiving. Another passage we see is in 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 1, and it's with David. And we see David's heart of worship in this passage. It says in verse 1, then David again gathered all the elite troops in Israel, 30,000 in all, and he led them to bring back the ark of God, which bears the name of the Lord of the heaven's armies, who is enthroned between the cherubim. Verse 5, David and all the people of Israel were celebrating before the Lord, singing songs and playing all kinds of musical instruments. I love that we've added another musical instrument to our worship team. Praise God. All instruments, singing and praising to the Lord. And it says that David went there and brought the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with a great celebration. And after the men who were carrying the ark of the Lord had gone six steps, it says David made a sacrifice. He sacrificed a bull and a fattened calf. And then look at this in verse 14. And David danced before the Lord with all of his might, with all of his heart. He gave it 100%, wearing the priestly garment. And so David and all the people of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouts of joy and the blowing of the ram's horn. David brought the ark to Jerusalem, and it transformed the city into a worship center. Think about that just for a moment. Two of David's greatest achievements as king, it's centered around the city of David, Jerusalem. The formation of Israel into a strong, unified nation, with its capital being well fortified, the city of Jerusalem. And the establishment of that city becoming the central location of worship of the Lord, as in it was Israel's greatest priority. David was saying, this is important. Now think about this for just a minute. He's probably one of the most successful men who ever lived. Let's look at his achievements just for a second. He was a king. He was a shepherd. He was a poet. He was a general. That's quite a list, right? He wrote most of the Psalms we have recorded in the Bible. He united kingdoms. He's a giant killer. He had an incredible lineup of achievements. The Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 18 that David continued to succeed in everything he did, for the Lord was with him. After he knocked off Goliath, he became a national hero. His name was known everywhere, and people even wrote songs about him. Saul has slain his thousands. David has slain his tens of thousands, right? They praised him. They adored him. The Bible says that all of Judah and Israel loved David. He was Mr. Popularity. He could do nothing wrong. He has one success after another, and David's response was that he gave all the glory to God. He gave all of it to God. He refused to take the credit. He refused to say, look at me. He said, look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. He gave all the credit to the Lord. Look at his attitude in Psalms 115, verse 1. Not to us, not to Israel, not to me, but to his name be the glory. Because of his love and his faithfulness, he gave all the credit, all the glory to God. He didn't let it go to his head. When everybody was praising him, he was saying, God, you get it all. You get all the credit. He had a humble and a thanksgiving heart. Now it's amazing to me that some of the qualities that most people overlook when they're looking for a great person is, you know, they don't look for humility. They don't look for a servant's heart. They don't look for a repentant heart or a trusting heart. You know, we know David did make a mistake. David did mess up. But David repented. David came back to God, and he had a trusting heart. And it was a heart that praises. It was a heart of generosity. It was a heart of thanksgiving. The very qualities that most people overlook in others when they're looking for greatness are the exact same qualities that God looks for when he says, that's a great person. That's a person after my own heart. That's a person who has it together. God says that the heart of the matter is the matter of the heart. The Lord does not look at the things that man looks at. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. David had a heart that overflowed with thanksgiving. And as we're rolling into this next week, I want to ask you the question, do we have that kind of heart? Do we have that kind of heart? Let's move on to Acts chapter 3 is another example with Peter and the lame man. And the Bible says in verse 1, that one day Peter and John were going up to the temple at a time of prayer at 3 p.m. Now a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. And when he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. I love this, man. This is one of my favorite stories. And Peter looked straight at him, as did John. And Peter said, look at us. So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, silver or gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. He gave what was in him, amen. And then taking him by the right hand, he helped him up. And instantly the man's feet and ankle bones became strong. And he jumped to his feet and he began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple of courts, walking and leaping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the man who was sick. He was the man who was begging, and now he's whole. Opportunity, and now he has opportunity. Now he can become the person that God wants him to be. But I love this. I think this verse fits the lame man's situations. It's Psalms 116, verse 12. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I will offer you a sacrifice of thanksgiving. I will call on the name of the Lord. I will say, look what the Lord has done. I will tell of the goodness and the greatness and the reliability of God. And the lame man, he overflowed with a thanksgiving. He went walking and jumping and praising God. He was making a statement. He was saying, look at my testimony. Look what God's done. Look what God's done. Another example we have is in Luke chapter 17. And it's verse 11. Verse 11 through 18, 19. And it's the story of the one leper. It says, it happened that as they made their way toward Jerusalem, that he crossed over the border between Samaria and Galilee, and he entered a village. 10 men, all lepers, met him, and they kept their distance, but raised their voice, calling out, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And taking a good look at them, he said, go show yourself to the priest. And they went, and while they were still on their way, look at this, they were still on their way. They hadn't even gotten there yet. While they were still on their way, they became clean. One of them, when he realized that he was healed, he turned around and he went back, shouting his gratitude, glorifying God. He kneeled at Jesus' feet. He's so grateful, he couldn't thank him enough. Verse 17, Jesus said, we're not 10 healed. Where are the 9? Where are the other 9? Can no one be found to come back and give glory to God? Then he said to him, get up. On your way, your faith has healed you. He said, didn't I heal 10 men? Where are the other 9? I love this because here's the thing. If you look at this from our standpoint, from us, you know, having received God's love, having received grace, and having received salvation, and having received all the spiritual benefits that Paul talks about, we must never forget to thank him. What he's done for us should cause us to continually to approach him with a grateful heart. John said it like this, we love him because he first loved us. We acknowledge him and his greatness because he first loved us. He loved you first. Come on. He loved you first. He's given me a new song. The psalmist would say, he's given me a hymn of praise to my God. And many will see what he's done and be amazed, and they will put their trust in the Lord. Oh, the joys of those who trust in the Lord, who have no confidence in the proud or in those who worship idols. Oh, Lord, my God, you have performed many wonders for me, for my life. Your plans for me are too numerous to list. You have no equal. If I tried to recite your wonderful deeds, I would never come to an end of the wonderful deeds that you've done for me, God, and that you've made available. Do you see the thanksgiving? Do you see the gratefulness? The one leper, he overflowed with thanksgiving. Are we like the one? Or are we like the nine? Are you like the one, or are you like the nine? Jesus is asking the question. I remind you today that on October 3rd, 1863, Abraham Lincoln said, "I do therefore invite my fellow citizens in every part of the United States and also those who are in foreign lands to set apart and observe the last Thursday of November next as a day of thanksgiving and praise." And look what he says, "to our beneficent Father who dwelleth in the heavens." Lincoln will go on and he'd say, "And I recommended them that while offering up a ascription justly due to the Father of the heavens, to him for such singular deliverances and blessings, that they do also with humble penitence and our national perverseness and disobedience, commend to his tender care all those who have become widows, orphans, mourners, sufferers in the lamentable civil strife in which we are unavoidably engaged. And I fervently implore the imposition," and he uses a big word right here, "of the Almighty." Of the Almighty. "His hand to heal the wounds of a nation and to restore it as soon as may be constant or consistent with the divine purpose, the full enjoyment of peace, harmony, tranquility, and union." He used the term Almighty. Think about that. That emphasizes God's power to work. When you use the word Almighty, when you call him Almighty, you're emphasizing his power. The psalmist said the same thing in Psalms 92. It is good to give thanks to the Lord and sing praises to your name, O Most High. The term O Most High shows God powerful. It shows God as the greatest. The Almighty is greater. And when we give thanks to God, We give God the glory for what he's done for us. Faithful, loving, powerful, good. Even Jesus recognized the greatness of the Father when he said, "For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." Jesus said, "Father, yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory. Forever." This is forever, Father. When we have an attitude of thankfulness, not only does our perspective change, this is a big statement, but we don't miss out on the opportunities that God is creating for us to bring glory and honor to him. Next week, we'll kind of shift into that. The opportunities that God gives us to bring glory and honor to him. When our focus and attention is where it's supposed to be, then we will be fulfilling his will. Did you hear what I said? The Bible says, "Be thankful in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you who belong in Christ Jesus." What does that mean? That means your gratefulness and your gratitude and your thanksgiving is expected. It's expected. This is God's will for us. And if we do it, our lives will be changed. Thanksgiving is the mark of a glowing Christian. Are you glowing? Come on. Turn to your neighbor and ask them if they're glowing. And we need to turn the lights off to see who's glowing. Are you glowing? I'm going to share a story with you. Some of you have heard it, but it's one of my favorite mission stories. It works well with Thanksgiving. And in 1996, Pastor Jack Hinton was leading a worship at a leper colony on an island. And there was time for one more song, so he asked if anyone had a request. And a woman who had been facing away from the pulpit, she turned around. And he says, "It was the most hideous face I had ever seen. The woman's nose and ears were entirely gone. They were completely gone. The disease had destroyed her lips. And she lifted a fingerless hand in the air and asked, 'Can we sing? Count your blessings.'" The old hymn, "Count Your Blessings." And overcome with emotion, he left the service. Pastor walked out. He walked out of the service, and one of his team members chased him down. He said, "Pastor, I guess you'll never be able to sing that song again." And he looked at him and he said, "Yes, I will. But I'll never sing it the same way." If I tried to recite all your wonderful deeds, I would never come to an end. Spiritual blessing, material blessing, physical blessing, external blessing, like community, nation, place you live, the church you have, the family that the Lord has given you, all the wonderful deeds. Think about all the wonderful deeds. Because of Jesus, you have purpose. Because of Jesus, you're called. You may say, "Well, Pastor, I'm not called." Yes, you are. You're called out of darkness and into light. You have salvation. You're blessed. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. You have health. You may say, "Well, Pastor, I've been sick." I want to encourage you. The scripture says, "By his stripes you're healed." And I want you to begin to thank God for your healing. Begin to thank God for the health that you have. You're made whole in him. The Bible says that that we can have fullness in God. He died to save you even when you were indifferent and you were against him. He still died to save you. He demonstrated his own love towards us that while we're sinners, that he died for us. The psalmist said, "Oh Lord, you've lifted me up. I cried out to you and you healed me to the end that my glory may sing praise to you and not be silent." Just like the lame man. "Oh Lord, my God, I will give thanks to you forever." See, what God desires for us is a life, not a day. It's a life. It's a life. It's a life of thanksgiving where every day, gratitude is expressed unto God. And here's the thing, that may be hard, that may sound difficult. I know the last 2 years have not been easy, but God is still on the throne. Jesus is still Lord of all. You still live in this wonderful country, and he loves you, and he cares about you, and he has great plans for you. And I think he's been walking us through some things so that we can grow. He's been working on our character. He's been testing our resolve. He's been wanting us to stay faithful, 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 and grateful, grateful, grateful through all of the stuff that we've had to deal with. And here's the thing. I don't think anything blesses God more than when we stop right in the middle of what we're doing and we lift our hands and we say, "Thank you, God. Thank you for one more day. Thank you for one more opportunity. Thank you for the privileges that you've put in my life. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise, for he is good." Amen. Can we give our everything to the one who's offered everything? And I want to do something this morning. I want everybody to join me right here. I want everybody to come down front. Every person in the house today. And maybe today you don't feel like thanksgiving, but the Bible says we bring a sacrifice of praise. Amen. The Bible says, I don't think I read it this morning. It says, "I will offer you a sacrifice of thanksgiving." And this morning, what I want us to do, I'm going to help you. Okay, I'm going to just kind of guide you a little bit. But I want you to come down front. And I want everybody to just take a minute, just raise your hands. And we're going to take a few minutes. And we're going to enter his gates with thanksgiving. And the way we're going to do this is I'm going to list something. And you're just going to begin to thank God for it, okay? And then I'll move on and I'll list the next thing. And I want you to begin to thank God for it. Some of you, I think, need to do this. Some of you this morning, I believe the Lord wants to restore the joy of your salvation. He wants to encourage you. He wants to fill you up. He wants you to experience him in a new way. And as we give thanks to God for all the many things, as we count the blessings, amen, of all the things that he's done for us, God will begin to work in our heart and in our life and begin to fill us with joy. and fill us with life and life more abundantly. The first thing we're going to thank God for this morning is spiritual blessings. And we're going to thank God for salvation. So I just want you to take a minute and I just want you to say thank you, Jesus, for salvation. Thank you for everlasting life. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sins. Thank you that I can know you. Thank you, God, that you didn't send your son into the world to condemn me. You didn't set me aside. You don't condemn me, but you came that I might have life and life to the fullest. Lord, we thank you for the many spiritual blessings of God. We thank you for the Holy Spirit that lives on the inside of us, that empowers us for the work of ministry, and that helps us every single day. We thank you for all the things that you want to do in our heart and our life as we move forward. And Lord, we thank you for the anointing of God. We thank you for the unction of the Holy Spirit to carry out the purposes. We thank you for the gifts of the Spirit. We thank you so much, Lord Jesus, for everything that you have done for us. You love us so much. We thank you for relationship, God. And so, Lord, this morning, like we talked about, we just stop for a minute and we say, thank you, God. Thank you for today. And Lord, I pray that this would carry over. God, this would carry over into our year, for the rest of the year. Lord, for the rest of our days, for the rest of our lives. God, that we would be a people that would stop and say, glory be to God. Not to us, but to your name. Be the glory. Because you picked me up out of the sin. You picked me up out of the clay. And God, you put my feet on the rock to stay. And God, I want to stay there. I want to worship you there. I want to honor you, Lord. I want to build my life on Jesus Christ. I thank you so much that I am blessed and I have relationship with the Lord. I thank you that every day your mercies are new. New every morning. And Lord, we can go to bed every night and say, the Lord is my portion. I thank you for that. I thank you for the spiritual blessings. And now I want you to thank God for the material blessings. I want you to thank God for the things that he's given you. For the works of your hands, the finances that you have, the position that you're in, the place you're at in your job. You know, maybe you're here and you're looking for a job. I want you to begin to thank the Lord for the job that he has for you. God, we thank you so much for the material blessings. We thank you for the word of God. We thank you that the Bible says you are Jehovah Jireh, the provider, and that your grace is sufficient. And so, Lord, those that are obeying the Lord, God, I pray, Lord, I pray the windows of heaven would fall on them in such a miraculous way. They'd be opened up, God, and the bounty of God, the bounty of heaven, Lord, would be poured out into their life. Lord, that they will not lack in Jesus' name. God, but that you will expand and that you will grow. Lord, you will enlarge their tent pegs, enlarge their territory like you did with Jabez, that they would be blessed indeed. Lord, bless the church. Bless the church in Jesus' name. Lord, that the church won't lack. The body of Christ won't lack. God, that if we obey, if we serve you with our finances, if we put those things first, Lord, and in the kingdom of God, Lord, you will open the windows of heaven. And Lord, those that are struggling with that, I pray you open the eyes of their heart. God, open the eyes of their mind, God, so they can see, Lord, the promises of God and understand that if I put my life in the kingdom of God, if I put my finances in the kingdom of God, that, oh, there's a bounty, there's a harvest, God, in a great way. I pray you'll do that. We thank you, God, for blessing us with the ability to sow seed. In Jesus' name, we thank you for that, God. We give you praise. And I want you to thank God this morning for your health. You know, maybe you're struggling with your health. Maybe you're fighting some things. You know, a lot of people have had to deal with COVID-19, and there's all this stuff that's happening in the world. But the Bible says, by his stripes we're healed. And listen, whatever's going on, wherever you're at, I want you to just thank God for the health that you have. He's given you one more day. Worship him with that day. Worship him with that health you have. And if you're sick, give it to the Lord. And let's watch the Lord work in your heart and life. God, we thank you that you're the God that healeth thee. Lord, the Bible says you took our sicknesses and you took our diseases. And by your stripes, we are healed. And so we just pray this morning for physical health. God, for every person. And God, I not only pray for physical health, but I pray that as they serve you and that as they love you and live for you, God, that you will give them long life in Jesus' name. Lord, we ask for your blessing, your physical, tangible touch. Lord, the Bible says that your body was broken for us. Lord, you took stripes for us. God, surely you bore our griefs. And by your stripes, God, by your stripes, Lord, those that aren't here today, that are in our church family, that are watching online, God, those that are all over the world watching online, I pray today you'll heal their body. I pray you'll touch them. Lord, I pray that the saints, God, I pray that the saints would live, God, so that they can preach the gospel. Lord, there's a lot to do in Alaska. There's a lot to do across the nation and across the world. God, I pray that you heal our bodies, touch our minds, so we can preach the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. God, there's more to do. There's so much to do. And I want you to thank God for the external blessings. I want you to thank him for your family. I want you to thank him for your kids. I want you to thank him for your church family, your friends, your neighbors, the place you live, North Pole, Alaska. I want you to thank him for the military. I want you to thank him for the United States of America. I want you to begin to give him praise for who he is and allowing you to grow up in this place, allowing you to be here. Just begin to thank him for those things. Lord, we thank you so much that you've called us to be here. And Lord, we know that our home is struggling. God, we know that the United States needs God in a powerful way. God, we know that blessing and freedom needs to survive. God, we know, Lord Jesus, that you have a great plan for this wonderful nation that we live in. Lord, from the east to the west, from the north to the south, God, you love America. Lord, you love the United States, and you love every person, Lord, in the United States. And I pray, Lord, that you'll help us to turn, help us to repent, help us to listen to you. God, help us not to do things that we shouldn't do. Help us to get our heart right and our mind right and our attitude right. And God, I just come against hate. God, the hate that's in the world, the hate that's in our nation, Lord, may we be a nation that's generous. May we be a nation that loves. And God, I pray that within our nation that there would be life and there would be peace. God, that there would be wholeness. Lord, position the church. The church has the answer, and it's Jesus Christ. Position the church. Put the church in the right spot. Put the church in the right position. And Lord, help the church to speak up. God, help the church to say and speak life, that you are the way, the truth, and the life, Lord Jesus. And God, I pray for our military members, Lord, all those that are serving, I pray you'll touch them and encourage them. I pray that they'll be strong and courageous, and Lord, that they'll know that they know that the Lord loves them. Lord, if they don't have a relationship with you, may they experience you, may they know you. God, we thank you for North Pole, and we pray for North Pole. God, we pray for souls saved. God, we pray for disciples made. God, we pray you'll give us influence in our sphere, our circle, Lord, the 5, 6, 10 blocks around us. Lord, all the way down Hearst, God, and up Lawrence and down Badger. God, we pray in Jesus' name for revival. And Lord, I pray you'll give our church some favor. You'll give us some increase. Lord, I pray that when people come here that they'll feel the love of God. And God, I pray that you'll give us wisdom and strategy and direction. Lord, as we love people and as we reach people. And God, help us not to be afraid to say, hey, man, Jesus loves you. You need to go to church. Come to church with me this week because God can meet you where you're at and heal you and pick you up and be the answer to your struggles. Give us wisdom, God. Give us unction. Give us anointing. Pour out the Holy Spirit of God on this church. In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Come on, let's give him praise. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Praise God. Lord, I pray that as we walk into Thanksgiving this week, God, from here on out, it's not just a day. It's a life. And God, we want to live that life. And Lord, I just believe, Lord, there's a Holy Ghost dance in some of these people. Lord, like David danced before the Lord with all his might. Lord, we dance before you and we love you and we worship you. We thank you, God. Let me read it one more time. The Bible says, Psalms 100, verse 5, I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart, his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all, every single generation. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. Enjoy your day. Pull for the Cowboys. Hug a neck on the way out. And Pastor Jesse's telling me about choir practice. Just a reminder. God bless you. Happy Thanksgiving. I love you all.
Hey, good morning, Norpol Assembly of God. It's been great having you with us today. Hope you enjoyed the service. Just a reminder, there's a couple different ways you can give. You can give online at northpoleag.org, or you can give by mail, North Pole Assembly of God, 503 Kitt Boulevard, 99705. We're praying for you. We hope you have a great week. God bless you.